So friends, now we will have a look what are three T's of combustion. So as you can see here, the three T's of combustion are, first one is temperature, the second is turbulence, and the third is time. For each fuel, we are having a minimum temperature that has to be attained so that the fire or the ignition of that fuel can take place. So the temperature corresponding to the ignition of the fuel once attained has to be maintained so as to keep our combustion in a continuous manner. Second is turbulence, which is nothing but the intimate mixing of fuel and oxygen. Because as I have already told you, what is combustion? Combustion is the burning of fuel in presence of oxygen. So the proper ignition or the proper combustion of the fuel will only occur when there is a proper mixing of fuel and oxygen. Suppose fuel is lying in the one corner, oxygen is lying on the other corner of the combustion chamber, and there is no intermixing of the two, then our combustion will not be proper. So our second T is very much important, that is turbulence, which is required for the mixing of fuel and oxygen. Our third T is time, because once the mixing of fuel and oxygen have started, so sufficient time is to be given so that the various reactions which are involved in the ignition or the combustion of the fuel takes place. Now to explain the three T's, I will take an example of a combustion chamber. This is a combustion chamber where the combustion occurs. In this combustion chamber, we are supplying the fuel and we are also supplying the air, and interaction of these two, air and fuel, takes place inside the combustion chamber, and the energy is released and the combustion products that will be formed will follow this route and escape out of the combustion chamber in the form of exhaust gases. So how we can understand the principles and the importance of these three factors? To explain this, I have considered an example. As you can see here, what I am doing here, I am preparing a hot coffee. So what are the things I need? I need sugar, I need milk, I need coffee, and I need a spoon. You will first pour the sugar inside, you will also pour the milk inside, and then you will also pour the coffee inside. Now the first thing here that is to be considered, that the milk should have sufficient temperature so that the sugar and the coffee melts into it very easily. But you also remember that just pouring all the three things will not do your work. So once all the things have been poured inside this jar, mixing is required. That is, all the things need to be mixed. How this can be done? This can be done with help of this spoon. You will take this spoon and you will stir the mixture, and you will keep on stirring till all the three things have been mixed properly. So as you stir the mixture, the three things will get mixed, and this mixing is required, then only a proper coffee can be made. Similarly here, once this fuel and air have been entered in the combustion chamber, there is a mechanism that is required which will ensure proper mixing of air and fuel. Or you can say, we need to agitate this mixture, or we need to create a turbulence. What is turbulence? Turbulence is nothing but agitation. Like you are mixing this coffee, as you stir the coffee, you are doing nothing, you are agitating the mixture. You are creating a turbulence so that the mixing of all the components is just and proper. Similarly, a medium or a mechanism is required here which will ensure the complete mixing of fuel and air. And what that mechanism will do, that will create a turbulence so that intimate mixing of air and fuel can take place. So how that is done, I will take up subsequently. So it is very much clear that the second step will be the proper mixing, and the third one, now the mixing has been carried out, but that stir or that mixing has to be carried out for certain time, because only then the flavors of the coffee can be brought out and you will have a good and a lovely coffee for yourselves. Similarly here, you have to give a sufficient time for the agitating mixture so that the reaction can complete in a just and a proper way and the maximum amount of energy has been released. So in the same way you can correlate. So the fuels initially has to be heated up to a threshold temperature at which it catches fire. So this is the temperature this fuel need to be attained. Then a turbulence is required in the mixture so that the air and fuel can mix in a good and proper manner. And once this mixture have been agitated and once the proper mixing have taken place, we need to give this mixture sufficient time so that all the reactions that are involved in between fuel and air takes place by itself in a complete manner. So for the proper combustion reactions and the proper amount of energy, heat energy to be released, sufficient time needs to be given to this agitating mixture. So these are the three T's which are required: temperature high enough to ignite and maintain ignition of this fuel. Turbulence is required. Why turbulence is required? For proper mixing of fuel and air. Here you can see, or you are creating turbulence with the help of your spoon. But here you cannot use your spoon. So you have to design some mechanism so that turbulence or agitation can be created in this combustion chamber. So the third thing, once the turbulence has been created, so you have to give sufficient time so that the various reactions that are involved in between the two can be completed in a proper and efficient manner, and the energy of the fuel is released in an optimum way. Now we will move to our next topic, that is excess air. So friends, as I have already told you that some turbulence is required for proper mixing of air and fuel. So how we are creating this turbulence in the combustion chamber? We are using this air itself for creating the turbulence. So you can easily see that the air which is supplied to the combustion chamber does two things. First, it is required for combustion, and in combustion the oxygen which is present in the air is taking part, as I have already told you. The second purpose of the air is to create agitation, to create a turbulence so that proper mixing of fuel and air takes place. Now suppose the fuel is having these three constituents, that is carbon, hydrogen and sulfur. And as you all know, as I have already told you, that for all the three constituents we are having three combustion equations. Suppose I am taking carbon, so the equation which will be applicable will be this one. Now subsequently I will explain you how to calculate the amount of oxygen that is required for the combustion of fuel. Now one thing from here is very much clear, that with reference to the quantity of carbon that is present in the fuel, we are having a definite quantity of oxygen that is required. So we can calculate the amount of oxygen required for the combustion of carbon. Similarly, from the combustion equations of hydrogen and sulfur, I can calculate the amount of oxygen required for the combustion of hydrogen and sulfur. So now it is very much clear that I can easily calculate the value of oxygen that will be required for the combustion of the various constituents of the fuel. And we need to supply that much oxygen for the complete combustion of fuel. But in actual, because we need to create a turbulence in the system, so we are supplying an extra air. So the air which is supplied in excess of the air which is required for combustion is called as excess air, which is nothing but it is supplied for creation of turbulence or agitation. So you can say that excess air is the air which is supplied in excess. In excess to what? In excess to what is required for the combustion. Actually for combustion air is not required. For combustion oxygen is required, but we cannot supply oxygen directly because we are not filtering out the oxygen and then we are supplying it to the combustion chamber. We are directly supplying the atmospheric air to the combustion chamber so that the combustion of the fuel takes place. Now as I have already told you that the oxygen value by weight in atmosphere is 23%. What does this mean? This means in 100 kg of air you are having 23 kg of oxygen. So as you can see here, this is the excess air, and the total air supply will be the summation of these two. So excess air is generally represented as percentage. Now I will recommend you to consider the combustion chamber just like a box where fuel and air is entering, and whereby reaction of fuel and oxygen is taking place inside, and the exhaust gases or the products of the combustion are getting out in the form of exhaust gases. So this is the picture that should be in your mind while you are calculating or you are doing various numericals which are linked with this topic. So friends, now we will move on to our next topic, which is stoichiometric combustion or air, or you can also say as theoretical air. So as I have already told you just before, that on the basis of the quantity of the constituents of the fuel, we can easily calculate how much oxygen is required for their combustion. So we will first calculate the amount of oxygen that we will be requiring for the combustion on the basis of the quantity of the various constituents present in the fuel and which will take part in the combustion reaction. Now based on the value of oxygen which we have calculated, we will calculate the value of air that will be required so as to supply the oxygen that we have already calculated. So that air which we have derived or calculated on the basis of our equations, or you can say on the basis of our theoretical equations, is called as theoretical air, because that air has been calculated on the basis of our theory, or I can say on the basis of our combustion equations. So first I will see what are the various constituents and the table which is given. So this is the analysis of a fuel, or I can say these are the constituents that are present in the fuel with respect to its weight. So carbon is present in the fuel with a percentage of 85.9% by weight. Hydrogen is present in the fuel and is having a percentage weight of 12%. Oxygen is present in fuel with a percentage weight of 0.7%. Similarly, you can calculate for others also. Now the first thing which we will have a look at this table is the various constituents that will be involved in the combustion equation. So on the basis of this table, I can say that the carbon will be involved in the combustion equation, hydrogen will be involved in the combustion reaction, oxygen will not be involved in the combustion reaction. Similarly, nitrogen is not involved in any combustion reaction. Now sulfur is involved. Similarly, water is not involved in any combustion equation. Similarly, ash is not involved in any combustion reaction. The oxygen is required for those constituents that are taking part in the combustion reaction. So from here we can easily see carbon, hydrogen and sulfur are the only constituents that will take part in the combustion reaction. Now we will be calculating the amount of oxygen that will be required by the carbon, hydrogen and sulfur for their combustion reaction. So first I will calculate for carbon. So for calculating the quantity of oxygen that will be required for combustion, we will have to remember the atomic or the molecular weight of the following constituents. I have written down it here, but you have to memorize the atomic weights for some of the elements. And I have written here just for the sake of your reference. The atomic weight of carbon is 12, hydrogen 1, oxygen 16, nitrogen 14, sulfur 32. As you know, for the carbon, the equation which is involved is this one, and this equation is very much balanced. Now, the atomic weight of carbon is 12, the atomic weight of oxygen 16, but we are having a molecule of oxygen over here which is having 2 oxygen atoms. So, the molecular weight will be 2 into 16, that will be equal to 32 kg. And what will be the molecular weight of CO2? So the molecular weight of CO2 can easily be calculated as, it is having one atom of carbon plus two atom of oxygen. It will come as 44 kg. So I can write it as 12 kg, 32 kg, 44 kg. From here you can easily see that 32 kg of oxygen is required for combustion of 12 kg of carbon. So I can write it as You can easily see from this equation that for combustion of 12 kg of carbon, 32 kg of oxygen is required. So I have written it as for 12 kg of carbon, oxygen required 32 kg. Now we will be using our basic unitary method. So for 1 kg of carbon, oxygen required will be 32 divided by 12. It is very much easy. Even if you have some doubt in this, you can comment in the comment section. Since it is given as percentage by weight, so I will consider 100 kg of fuel. 100 kg of fuel. Now the weight of various constituents have been given by percentage by weight. So I will consider 100 kg of fuel for my calculation. So in 100 kg of fuel, how much carbon is present? Now carbon present in fuel is 85.9% by weight, but I have considered my fuel as 100 kg. So this means carbon present in fuel will be equal to 85.9 kg. Now I will calculate the oxygen required for combustion of 85.9 kg of carbon. So we can see for combustion of 85.9 kg of carbon, oxygen required is 229.07 kg. I have written it here. Next we will see the combustion of hydrogen. Now as the atomic weight of hydrogen is 1, so the molecular weight of H2 will be 2 kg. Now weight of oxygen molecule will be 2 multiplied by 16, as the atomic weight of oxygen atom is 16 and I am having the factor of 1 by 2, so I will be multiplying it by 1 by 2. I am not calculating the value of H2O because I am concerned only in the amount of oxygen that is required. Now you can easily see from this equation that for combustion of 2 kg of hydrogen we require 16 kg of oxygen. So from the unitary method you can again see for 1 kg of hydrogen, oxygen required will be 16 divided by 2, that is coming as 8 kg. Now the hydrogen present in the fuel is 12% and I have considered 100 kg of my fuel, so the hydrogen present in my fuel will be 12 kg. So from this the value of oxygen required for the combustion of 12 kg of hydrogen will be equal to 12 multiplied by, that is what we require for the combustion of 1 kg of hydrogen. So for this question, for the combustion of 12 kg hydrogen, oxygen required is 96 kg. Now similarly, the only constituents of the fuel left that will be used in the combustion reaction is sulfur. So the combustion reaction of the sulfur follow this equation, and from here if you put the values of atomic and molecular weight correspondingly, we will finally get that for 32 kg of sulfur we require 32 kg of oxygen for its combustion. So you can say for 32 kg of sulfur, oxygen required is 32 kg from this equation. So simply applying the unitary method again, for 1 kg of sulfur, oxygen required will be 32 divided by 32 and this will come as 1 kg. Now sulfur in fuel is present at the rate of 0.5% by weight. Now I have assumed 100 kg of fuel. So as per 100 kg of fuel, the sulfur that will be present will be 0.5 kg. So for 0.5 kg sulfur, or I can say for combustion of 0.5 kg sulfur, the oxygen required will be 0.5 multiplied by 1, because for 1 kg of sulfur I require 1 kg of oxygen. So 0.5 kg of sulfur I will require 0.5 kg of oxygen. So accordingly I will write it here as, now you can see here there are only 3 constituents that are taking part in the combustion reaction, and correspondingly I have calculated the value of oxygen that will be required for the combustion of these constituents on the basis of the quantity of carbon, hydrogen and sulfur present in the fuel. So I can say the total amount of oxygen that is required for the combustion will be 229.07 plus 96 plus 0.5, and this will come as 325.57 kg. So I can say for combustion of 100 kg of fuel, I require this much kg of oxygen. Now if you see here that the fuel is already having some oxygen in itself, and what about the value 0.7% by weight. Since I have considered 100 kg of fuel, so the amount of oxygen already present in fuel is 0.7 kg. You can see it from here. Now, the oxygen required for the combustion is 325.57 kg and this much oxygen is already present in the fuel. So, the amount of oxygen present in the fuel will be used from there itself for the combustion. And the rest of the oxygen required, which is the balance oxygen required for the combustion, will be 325.57 kg that we have calculated minus 0.7 kg that is already present with the fuel. So this much, that is 324.87 kg is the oxygen which is required. So I can say that 324.87 kg of oxygen is required for the combustion of 100 kg of fuel. But as I have already told you, I am not supplying the oxygen directly. I am supplying oxygen in the form of air. So what I need to calculate now, that for the supply of this much oxygen, 324.87 kg oxygen, how much air we need to supply to the fuel. So that can be calculated very easily. Now friends, we have calculated the amount of oxygen that is required for the combustion of 100 kg of fuel, and that is coming as 324.87 kg. Now friends, as I have already told you, that oxygen present in air by weight is 23%. You have to remember this thing. So the percentage of oxygen by weight in air is 23%. What does this mean? This means that in 100 kg of air, 23 kg of oxygen is present. Now we require how much amount of air we need to supply so as to supply 324.87 kg of oxygen. In 100 kg of air, 23 kg of oxygen is present. This is the meaning of this 23%, or I can rewrite it as, for 23 kg of oxygen, air to be supplied is 100 kg, because in 100 kg air, 23 kg of oxygen is present. So by using the simple unitary method, I can say for 1 kg of oxygen, the air required to be supplied will be 100 divided by 23. This is simple unitary method. So the oxygen which we require for this case is 324.87 kg. So for 324.87 kg oxygen, air required will be 100 multiplied by 23. That is what is required for 1 kg of oxygen, multiplied by the total quantity of oxygen that is required, and it will come as 1412.47 kg. So I can say that for complete combustion of 100 kg of fuel, I will require 324.87 kg of oxygen, and for that I require 1412.47 kg of air. Now, since I have calculated for 100 kg of fuel, I can write it as, the air required will be 1412.47 kg divided by 100 kg, and it can be written as 14.12 kg air per kg of fuel. For combustion of 1 kg of fuel, I require 14.12 kg of air. So here you can see that this quantity of air I have calculated on the basis of the stoichiometric equations, or the combustion equations, you can say. So this is nothing but it is the theoretical air, I can say. So this is nothing but it is the theoretical amount of air that is required for the combustion of fuel. So friends, this is how we can calculate the theoretical air which will be required for the combustion of fuel on the basis of the oxygen requirement as per the combustion equation, depending on the quantity of the various constituents of the fuel that will take part in the combustion reaction. Now, what about the other things? This oxygen will be used in the combustion itself. This nitrogen will be passed as such in the combustion product, because this is not taking part in any reaction. Similarly, this moisture which is present in fuel will convert into water vapor by absorbing the latent heat of evaporation. and this S, that is 0.05%, will remain as such in the combustion chamber since it will not take part in any of the reaction. So this is how we can calculate the theoretical amount of air and we can use in our various numericals. So friends, I think up to this level it is very much clear to you all. Subsequently we will see how we can calculate the excess air. So in this video it is up to this level only. In my subsequent video I will be telling you about the excess air and how it can be used while we are solving our various numericals. So friends, this is all for the day. And yes, I will recommend you that you should watch my every video right from start to the end so that you can get each and every concepts and you will never face any misconceptions of any sort. So I hope this topic is very much clear to you all, and I will request you to kindly like and share the video and do share it with your friends and colleagues who are preparing for this BEE examination.